Okay, good morning, everyone. My name is Jill Florent. I'm on the QuickSight PM team, and I'm just going to give a few kind of getting started pointers. Really happy that you could join us here today. We're here to talk about building advanced analytics and dashboards with QuickSight. I'm very pleased in a moment to present to you Sapna Maheshwari, who's our QuickSight Solutions Architect, who'll be leading us through the activities. Just from a scheduling standpoint, I did want to note that the first hour and 45 minutes, we'll be doing a component on Dashboard Building 101, and then having just a short break, and then we'll move into Dashboard Building 201. I know that there was maybe a typo in the registration, but this is scheduled to go from 8 a.m. Pacific to 11 a.m. Pacific. And the session will be recorded. So our plan is that after the session is over, within a day or two, we'll actually post the recorded version to our Amazon QuickSight YouTube channel and send you all a link to that. One of the things that I wanted to flag for you as well is that you may have questions during the session today, and there's kind of two different places that we would encourage you to bring us your questions. If you have a question that relates exclusively to the webinar itself, the workshop activities that we're going through today, like what was just said, I missed that, or something logistically, that would be a good thing to post right inside the question area on the right side of your GoToWebinar panel. Just click question and it'll go to myself and other QuickSight moderators. But these will not be saved nor sent. So if you have a question that relates to something that you'd like to be able to refer back to, I would encourage you to actually leverage the QuickSight community. And so there's a link that you can click directly in the upper right-hand corner, just where your name is. If you are looking at your QuickSight homepage, you can click community, and then that takes you to this area where you can actually click the word post and then ask a question. And you'll find that this is where questions have already been asked and answered. So as I was going to be posting here, I could type in data set and it might actually pop up something that had already been asked and answered. And then when you actually post that question, to make it easy to find, you can add a tag and just put in virtual workshop or something. And this is kind of the better place to ask questions that might relate to something general within QuickSight. So without further ado, I'd love to go ahead now and turn it over to Sapna, and let's get started in just a moment.
Hello and welcome everyone to Building Advanced Dashboards with Amazon QuickSight workshop today. I am Sapna Maheshwari, QuickSight's Specialist Solutions Architect at AWS. I have several years of experience managing and leading projects in the data and analytics space. I love telling stories with data and helping customers unearth actionable insights from their data. I'm very excited to be presenting this workshop today, and here is the agenda. So starting now up to 9:45 a.m., like Jill mentioned, we'll be doing 101 QuickSight exercises, like creating various visuals and how to format them so they look a little better. And then how can we add interactivity to those dashboards using parameters, action filters, and drill down. We'll also go over machine learning features that come in with QuickSight, which is forecasting and anomaly detection. And finally, we will be publishing and sharing a dashboard. We'll show how your dashboards can be emailed to users on your account and many more features of QuickSight. We'll take a break at 9:45 a.m. for 15 minutes and come back at 10 a.m. this is the time when we will be doing advanced calculations, calculated fields, table calculations, and level-aware aggregations. So by the end of the session, you would have created a dashboard that is not only insightful, but also beautiful, interactive, and packed with machine-generated insights. Like Jill mentioned, this session is recorded, and I will try to go at a moderate speed so you can follow along. But just in case you missed something, then like Jill mentioned, either you can send it on the chat, or you can just note the time when you missed it and then play the recording later. Or you can just wait for a bit and catch up from the next visual or the next calculated field. Yeah, whatever method you choose to follow along in this workshop, I am positive that at the end of the session, you'll be able to create dashboards in QuickSight with much greater confidence. With that, let's dive into QuickSight. Jill, should we send the link to the data set?
Yep, it should be in the chat window now. So if you click on the link that's shared in the chat, that will be, there's a blue button that allows you to download the data set that we'll be using today. And so everybody should go ahead and look in the chat window, click on that link, and then click that blue click to download data file for the workshop button. And just let us know if you have any issues with that. But if you've just logged in, it may not have popped up. So let me repost it to the chat window now.
Okay, I'll give a couple minutes for everyone to download the data set and have it ready. In the meantime, I just wanted to go over this particular page. Once you get into QuickSight and you do the Create Dataset button, it brings you to this page right here, where it shows all the data sources that can be connected to QuickSight. So as you can see, QuickSight has the provision to upload flat files like CSV, Excel, and such. You can also connect to hosted databases like RDS, Redshift, Aurora, Athena, S3. You can also connect to on-premises database like MySQL, PostgreSQL, and SQL Server, or any third-party applications like Jira, ServiceNow, Adobe Analytics. For the purposes of today's workshop, we will be only connecting to Excel file or the CSV file which was sent. And hopefully everybody has it right now on their system. So we'll start today. Once you log into your QuickSight portal, click on data sets and say new data set. And that should bring you to this page, which is the data source. Once you are here, select upload a file. And that will open the browser, the browsing window where you can browse to your file, which is the patientinfo.csv, and open it. This will start the process of uploading the file. What it is doing right now is loading that file into QuickSight's internal storage called SPICE. SPICE is an acronym for Superfast Parallel In-Memory Computation Engine. What it basically is a cache layer. So you can see that your dashboards and your visuals render very fast, and any interaction using parameters or filters will not have to do a round trip to your database, because the data set or a snapshot of that data is brought into QuickSight's internal storage. So that is the advantage of using SPICE. Let me talk a bit of limitations of SPICE so you can better make the judgment of whether you should be using SPICE or a direct connect. So whenever you connect data source to QuickSight, or the other way around, whenever you connect QuickSight to a data source, you'll be given two options. One is to bring it into Spice or to do a direct connect. Like I mentioned, Spice is an brings in the data within the internal storage. But with a direct connect, every time you interact with the dashboard or load the dashboard, a query is sent by QuickSight into your data source and it brings the data into your visual. So that way your data is more fresh and up to date. But with Spice, since it is a snapshot of data at a particular time, it will be as old as the last refresh. Today, we allow to go all the way. The most frequent refresh schedule is an hourly schedule. So you can get in data every hour. This can be scheduled and automatically your data set will get updated with the latest data every hour. Coming back to the CSV file upload, once the upload is done into Spice, you will see a preview of your data right here, and you can quickly see if all the columns and the rows are and the rows and the column types look accurate and good enough for you. You can click next. And then either from here, you can go to visualize or you can do edit and preview data. You also have an option to augment with SageMaker. So SageMaker is our, if you have any models running on your SageMaker, then that can be that can be brought into QuickSight as well. Now we will do edit and preview data. And you can see it's directly having a Spice right here. You don't see an option of direct query because with Excels and with an S3 data source connectivity, data will be automatically brought into Spice because there is no way for QuickSight to get into your system and see what the data is, whether it is updated and things like that. So for those purposes, for flat files, which you're directly uploading, and for S3, the data will be automatically brought into Spice and you will not see the option of choosing a direct query or not. So right now you see the data is brought into Spice and you see the name right here of the data set. If you don't want this name, then you can just change this name to whatever you like. I'm going to be naming it as workshop. Once I've done that, you see that there is all these columns right here of my data set. Now say, I see that the patient ID column is marked as an integer. So QuickSight will read the data in your data set and infer what the data type is. So it knows this is a decimal data type, this is a date data type. It's also able to identify that this is a geographical data type. So each of these symbols right here will help you identify what the data type it is. If you think something is incorrectly marked, then you have the capability for changing that. For example, the patient ID is definitely an integer, which is correct. But for the purposes of my visualization, I want to just identify a patient. I don't want to do any aggregations like average, maximum, or some of the patient IDs because that will not make sense. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to make this integer into a string. So I just click on the integer data type and say string. So now you will see that your patient ID is converted into a string. So when you bring in this particular field in your visuals, it will not make it as a, it will not directly put it in the value shelf. And it will not start putting aggregations like sum and things like that on it. So very good, I like that. Now I also want to change the name of a certain field. Say for example, I have something called a payer segment. It's a very long name and on my table, it will, I don't want it to be a very long name on my table. And so what I'm going to do is the pencil icon right here, I'm going to click on that and just say payer. So I'm able to change the name of the column. So So I did two things. I changed the name of the column, and I also changed the data type of a particular column. Now, if you want to reduce the amount of data brought into your Spice and reduce the size of your data set, then you have on the bottom of your screen, left bottom, you will see add filter. This helps you to filter out certain records from your database, from your data source, so your data set is not as large. So I'm going to be filtering on, say, a particular physician. Right here. And click again on that physician, and that's where you would see include. Right now, I want to exclude two physicians. So I'm going to change that filter to exclude and type the name of the physician which I want to exclude. Let's see a few physicians right here. I'm going to exclude, say, Perry and cement. Right, so one value per line. You don't have to put commas. You don't want to put them in the same line. Instead, put them by hitting the return key or enter key. You should be able to go to the next line and add as many values as you would like. So this will help me reduce the size of my data. Going back to the field, all fields selected, click on the arrow there. So that's one way of reducing your data. Another way is that if you have a lot of columns and you're sure that you don't want to use all of these columns into your visualization, then you can remove that right here so that your data set is again reduced in size. So there is a field called service, and I know for 100% sure I am that I will not be using this particular field. So I will just uncheck this. So this reduces the data size further. I'll hit save. When I do that, it brings me to the data set page right here, and I can see my data set is created. When I click on this data set, you will see options right here. And you can do row level security, wherein you, when you have users, different kind of users who have to see certain data, for example, your territories, certain salespeople are able to see only certain territories, then you would be able to hide the rest of the territories or show only on a needed basis by using the row level security. The way row level security is implemented is that you have to create another data set, which is outside of your main data set. And that data set will hold the rules for the row level security. And then right here, you can also share this data set with other people in your account. So they can use that data set. They don't have to repeat that step of creating this whole data set, cleaning it, renaming fields and things like that. Once you have done it and it is in a good shape, you can share it with other users and they can start using that data set for creating their dashboards. So this is a very good way for collaboration and making sure everybody is working off of the same data. So it's like a single source of truth, and everybody creating reports out of that data set will have the same and consistent numbers. And then if you want, you can delete the data set. You can just duplicate the data set, and you can now edit the data set, or you can start creating an analysis out of it. I'll again go back to edit data set, and I want to show you the join capabilities that QuickSight has. So right here is add data. So I currently just have one flat file. I'm going to add data here. Here I can switch data source, which means if I have any sources created, they will be listed right here for me. you don't have to follow along from this piece because I am not going to be joining any data for our exercise today. This is just to show you the capability of joining. So just watch, you don't have to bring in any extra data right now. So when you do, say for example, I'm selecting this particular Athena data source. And it will load up all the schemas right now. And this is the table within that schema. I'm going to be selecting that. Right here on the screen, you also have an option of using custom SQL. So if you don't want the entire table, but you know your SQL, you can also do that. So both the ways are possible. And you select. Once you bring in that new data source, you will see that there are these pink dots right here. If you click on it, you will see the option of choosing which join type you want to do. And it will also give you the option of selecting the join field. Right now, this data sets are not related. These data sources are not related. So this doesn't make sense. But this is how you would go and join data sets. If you have more than one join clause, then you can do that by adding a new join clause as well. So I'm going to cross this out and say you want to add another, join another data source and snowflake it. So when you do add data and you can upload another file. And say I have something called this. Another Excel file I brought into it. So it's automatically creating it like this, but say you want to snowflake it, you drag this and drop it right here, hover over here until you see that green box. This is not a very easily discoverable feature, so I wanted to make sure to show this. When you hover over it and let go of your mouse, that's when you can now snowflake it and do the same thing. You can choose the join type and add the fields right here, the joining fields. So that's how you're doing join right now. I'm going to cancel out of it. So nothing is saved now because I just canceled and I have my data set as I had created until I changed the name and filtered it. So now I'm going to edit again and show you one more feature, which is right here in the dataset pane, is the calculated field. There are two ways you can add a calculated field. One is right here on your dataset page, and you would say add calculated field here. And I'm going to just add a field called target. Say your the hospital manager wants a target of 4 million. So I'm going to create, and this target is not existing in my data set. So I'm going to be creating an artificial field, a calculated field, and I'm going to be putting a 4 million number right here. And I click, and I'm going to name it target, save. Now you'll see a calculated field being created. This is the calculated field target created with the 4 million. Every single row in your data set will have the 4 million value. Now, when we finally use this in our visualization, we will have to be careful because it's adding 4 million at the lowest grain of your data, which is the patient ID. Patient ID and the admit date. The same patient might be admitted on a different date or a different hospital. So the lowest granularity is the patient ID and the admit date. And the hospital. So this is added for everything. So we'll have to use caution when we use this. We cannot use a sum on the target because it will be exploding, multiple counting that number. We'll have to use an average or a minimum so that it is projected correctly. So now I've added a calculated field. When you add a calculated field on this page, it will be listed here and it is materialized. What it means is that it looks very similar to the number fields or the decimal fields which are coming from my data set itself, from my data source itself. But when you create a calculated field within the analysis, which I'll be showing in a bit, you will see the difference between, you will see that calculated field with an equal to sign, and you can see that later. So this is all the capabilities that you have on this dataset page. I'm again going to click, now I'm going to click save and visualize. And this gets me into the workshop analysis. So whatever dataset name you gave, it will just append the analysis on it. If you want to change the name of the analysis, then you can do it by clicking hospital. I'm going to be naming this as Hospital Insights because I'm going to be doing some hospital related data. I'm going to be working on that. You see it's starting to import data into SPICE. And I want to draw, while it is doing that, you can see that this is what shows that it is in progress. You can see the visual types that we have here. And we have many more coming down the pipe. By the end of this month or early next month, you should see waterfall and funnel charts and things like that. Right here, you have visualize avenue. When this is on the visualize, when on the visualize marker here, you will see your field wells, you will see this pane basically. When you go onto filters shelf, you'll be able to create filters and add filters and parameters and things like that. We'll walk through each one of these as we progress along. I'm going to refresh this page, this browser itself to see if it is complete. So yeah. Now it is 100% success. So I have all my 8,200 rows imported into SPICE. Now I'm ready to start using my fields right here. So very first visual that we will create is using admit date and revenue. A very easy way to find out your fields is to click on this magnifying glass right here and start typing the name of the field if you know it, and it will pop that up for you. So if you have a lot of fields in your data set, then you don't have to scroll down. You can just search it and it will populate that for you. And just by clicking on it, it will automatically add it depending on what field you have selected. It will add it either to the x-axis, value, shelf, or depending on your visual type that is selected, you will have more or less shells right here. Now you see that this is an automatic autograph mode, which means QuickSight will automatically determine what is the, let me quit here. Okay. So QuickSight will automatically determine what is the best way to show this data. When you are comparing, when you are seeing a metric over a certain time period, the best way to see that is using a line graph. And that's what's done. In even though it is in the auto mode, it is showing you the line chart because that's the best way to visualize a time series data. Now you see that it is too busy and it is too crowded. And if I want to, it's, you can see it's showing from January, then it's skipping 3 months, because that's the space it has. So if I want to go in more detail and kind of zoom in, with that you can hover over this scroll bar right here and bring it in. When you do that, you see how it is zooming in, and you can stop it to the level which you are comfortable with. And so now I like it like this. So now I can see January 1st, I can see January 2nd, I can see 3rd, 4th, every single day I can see. But what has happened is now it's just brought me to May 6, 2015, but I have data all the way to 2018. So I can maintain this zoom level and hover over this until you see a four point mouse and scroll. So now at this zoom level, you're able to see all your data up to 2018. Okay, so now I'm going to bring it back to the original Zoom level, completely zoomed out. And it's busy. So I'm going to aggregate it to a higher level, say here. That's too much of aggregation, and I'm not able to get a lot of insights. So I would go with the month level. This is good for me. I'm now able to see a good trend of my revenue over the years. I'm going to make it a little smaller so that when I actually create this entire dashboard, it fits into the whole scheme. So now you see that it is at the month level. You see a lot of peaks and valleys, but one valley right here is of interest to me because that's the lowest dip ever. So I want to see what has been happening here. I just click on it and I see an option called Analyze Contribution to Revenue. Click on that. Now, I know there is a dip in the revenue in this point in time, but what are the key drivers, or what is it that has caused this dip? So contribution to analysis helps you to find that out. I have the capability to select up to four fields to analyze what has gone, what is happening behind the scenes of this revenue. Is it a particular category which has caused that dip? Is it because of a particular physician or a particular hospital or a particular region? So I'm selecting these four fields right here. You may select any fields that you'd like, but for this purpose, I've selected these four fields, and you have the capability to change your contribution, your time frame, but I leave it as such, and I'll say analyze. So now it's analyzing what is contributing to this dip, and you can see that the number one contributor is the medical category, which decreased from 106,000 to just 47,000 in that particular time frame. And so it contributed to the 64% of the total decrease. Same thing, physician Hall, his revenue decreased to a zero at that particular time frame. South Hospital revenue went down from 129,000 to just 45,000. So you're able to get to insights very quickly. And that's why the name QuickSight. So you're able to find out what are your key drivers, what actions, what insights you get, and then how do you action on those insights. That's the whole idea of visualization. So I've gotten a good peek at behind the scenes what is happening. So I'll hit the visualize right here. And we will now add forecasting, which is one of the machine learning generated features, ML features. You have the three dots right here on the overflow menu. And when you click on that, you have an option called add forecast. So you click on add forecast. In orange, what you see is the forecasted values. My data ended on December 2018. So 40 periods forward up to February 2020, it has brought in a forecast. The algorithm which QuickSight uses is called the random cut forest algorithm. And it is, you can see the band around that orange line. So that band is like you have the upper limit and the lower limit. This is the upper limit and this is the lower bound. So within this range is what your values in the future will lie. Now you see this is the prediction interval 90, which means there is a 90% probability that your points in future or your revenue in future will be within this range. Say you did not care about so much of an accuracy, so you can adjust this. So now it says like if there's 55% probability and you click apply, that's when it updates. Now you see the band has become more tighter, which means that you get a narrow range of your forecast, but at the same time, you have to remember that there is only 55% probability that this will lie within this range. I'm going to change it back to 95%. 90 is good. And now I have this graph here. By default, it plots at 14, but it is configurable. You can go back only, say, 12 months. you have to hit apply. And we have something called backcast as well, which basically means that if you want to go back in time and see how this model is working for you, I've done four periods backwards, and you can see this is what it would have plotted. If you would have run this model or you've run this forecast in September 2018, then this is what it would have given you. This is made up data, so it's obviously off, but if your data set is real, and then you'll be able to see that it is in line with your actual values. So I'm going to make this also zero and say apply. So with that, we have our very first visual created in QuickSight. Now we will create another visual, which is the donut chart. The way you add another visual right here is either going right here and saying add a visual, or you can do duplicate visual. If you want to use the same fields and things like that, so that will save you some time, you can either duplicate or you can add a visual. I'm going to just add one visual here, and I'm wanting to look for profit of hospitals. So I'll bring profit and hospital. So as you saw, since it was in auto mode, the best way to show categorical data is by categories. If you want to see a measure, then it's a bar graph is the best way to show that. So it's done that, but I want to do it, see it like a donut chart. So I'm going to click on this donut right here, and now it's made it a good looking donut chart. You see that the names are there. This is a legend right here, and you can, it's truncated, so you can move it in a bit. So it's now adjusted. But I see that the legend is not adding a whole lot of value. The reason being that the labels are right here in front of these colored slices. So this is not adding value. I might as well use this space for something else. So I'm going to be removing this. You click on the gear icon right here, and you will see this menu right here, which will give you a lot of options to do a lot of formatting. For now, I just want to hide the legend. So I'm going to click here. And there are two things right here you could do. You can either just hide the title, which is the hospital, or I can hide the entire legend. So now my legend disappears automatically. And now I'm going to make this a little smaller so that I'm starting to create a grid-like structure for my fully completed dashboard. Okay, now I see that these are a lot of decimal places. I don't need so much of accuracy. So I'm going to be clicking on the value shelf on the profit, because I want to format that particular metric. And I'm going to say format and more formatting options. If I click, it will bring up this menu for me. And here I can configure whether I want the separator to be a dot or a comma. And then I can say how many decimal places I want. Right now, I'm just happy with just one decimal place. So it's automatically brought into a one decimal place of 1.5 million there. It looks good to me. So this is the sum of profit by hospital. Now the next one that I, sorry about that. The next one, what I want to do is do a KPI chart, which is this one. So I will add a visual, make it a little smaller so it fits into that space that I have here. So I need to adjust this. Okay, looks good. So I'm going to make this a KPI chart, and it says that I need one measure value So either you can, with this KPI charts, either you can have two measures, so comparing two measures, or you can have one measure which is compared across two time frames. For this chart, I'm going to be doing one measure which is compared across two time frames. So admit date, and I'm wanting to see the revenue. So what is this number right here? You see, it is comparing the last two numbers of your last two, the latest two dates in your data set, which is December 31 and December 30. But I don't want this to compare the 2 days. I want to compare the last 2 years' data. So I'm going to be aggregating this from a day level to a, if I do month level, for example, it's going to compare November and December, which is the last 2 months. But I want to do the last 2 years. So I aggregate to a year level and I'm able to see the difference. Now you can see their actual values. 2017 was 4.1 million and 2018 was 4.5 million. So you can see the difference of the two is 408,000. But I don't like that it's doing a plain subtraction and giving me this. I rather want to see the difference in percentage. So the way you can do that is by clicking on the gear icon right here, and it shows you a lot of options, menu options right here for formatting. I don't want to see these numbers, 2017 and 2018 numbers, or before that, I want to see this as a percentage. So it's like 109% increase from the last year, or I just want to see the difference as a percentage. So 9.86%. It has gone up from 2017 and 2018. And I don't want these numbers. I just want to know this one. So I'm going to say that show the primary value only. So now you see the 2017 and 2018 numbers disappeared and you are able to see only the percentage difference. Now I might want to change the title right here so it is more descriptive and not misleading. So I'm going to say year over year revenue. 2017, 2018 versus 2017. And then I don't want a lot of decimal places, so I'm going to format that as well. Before that, I want to show that if you don't like this arrow, then you are also able to uncheck this box, so it will not show the arrow. Instead, it will just say whether it is a plus or a minus percentage difference. I'll click back. I like the arrow, so I'm just going to keep it like that. And again, you would want to change the formatting. I'm changing the formatting of the revenue, not the year. So I have to click here and change the format to just a number. So it's just making it to 10% increase. Okay, year over revenue is 10%. And I'm going to make it a little more smaller because I can add one more metric here, one more visual, and I'm going to duplicate the visual. Just bring it right here. Perfect. Here, what I'm going to do is I'm going to do profit. Instead of revenue, I want profit. So I'll just look for profit and replace that. Okay. Again, I can change the formatting from here as well. So it's an 8% decrease. Now you see what is happening. Although the revenue is increased, the profit is decreased. So what's going on? Maybe the cost has also increased along with your revenue. The cost has also increased, so ultimately your profit is down. So we want to now look into what is happening with the cost. So for that, we create another visual, and I want to see the cost now. So I'm going to bring in cost. And I want to drill down now. Everything is done at a very high level, at the year level or the hospital level. So I want to drill down a little bit and bring in category as well. Okay. And also because I'm comparing 2017 and 2018, so I'm going to bring the admit date on color. So it will split out the, I'm going to change the aggregation to year so I don't have so many colors. So now I can see the cost changing over the various years. But since I'm comparing only 2017 and 2018 in these metrics, I want to now filter this also to show only 2017 and 2018. So I'll add a filter. So click on the filter on the left here and say create one filter. And I want to create the filter on the admit date and click on it again to see more options right here. The time range between, I want to see it between 2018. 2018-1-1 and I want 2017 and 2018-31, right? I want the entire year of 2017 and 2018. So I'm going to make this, you can either change it right here in December, go all the way to December and 31st and click outside of it. So now I have the whole 2017 and the whole of 2018. I'm going to including the start and the end dates as well and click apply. So now you see that you have 2017 and 2018. I'm going to make this visual a little smaller so it's a grid-like structure for me. Neatly arranged as columns and rows, all the visuals. Okay. So you can see clearly your 2017 cost were lower than your 2018 cost, and that's what probably has caused your profit to go down. I'm also going to now add a reference line right here just to see what my average cost is. So that's a new feature, relatively new feature of adding reference lines. Click on the gear icon right here and you see reference lines. Click on it on the left and say add a new line. By default, you see that it has added a constant line on the value 10. So I want to draw a constant line on value 1000. So you see the constant value has changed. But that doesn't do any good in my case. I want to know the average cost. So I can either edit this line or you can add multiple reference lines as well. Right now, I'm just wanting only one reference line. So I can, if you click here, you will see a calculated line and a constant line. You can either have a constant or calculated line. So I'll do a calculated line right here. And I'm after the cost, average cost of my average cost, right, across the years and the categories. I can change this color right here and say it wants to be a brown color. Maybe blue. Okay, so I have that line right here and you can see it's giving me that value 2808, that exact with the decimal places. That's the average it has determined, but I don't want it because it's kind of between 2 and 4, and I know it's on average it's 3, so I really don't want that line, that label. So I'm just going to remove that and say done. So with that, I have a reference line right here. Now I want to dig deeper. Now I know the cost has increased, the profit has decreased. Is there anything else which is any other insights that I can get from my data? So I'll add another, I'll duplicate this visual right here. And this time we are going to create a table and we can add conditional formatting as well to the table. I'm going to make it a little small so that entire thing can fit into without a scroll bar. Okay. So now I'm going to change this to a table. Okay. Because I duplicated this visual, if you see on the filter shelf, you do have the 2017 and 2018 carried forward with it. Okay, so now we have this data right here. I'm going to just, I want the admit date before the category. So you can just, when you start to drag it over admit date, it will give you the option of replace or add. Choose add and then add. So that way it's not replaced. You still have your category as well as this. Now, I want to know if there is a relationship between discount and profit. So for this purpose, I'm going to add, click on visualize and add discount. Click on discount, it adds another column for discount and click on profit. Okay, so now I added discount and profit and cost. Because cost is already right here, I am not wanting to, I'm just going to remove the cost. All right, so now I have discount and profit. Now I want this this to kind of pop out if there are any, there are so many rows. I don't want to, again, going back to the principle of getting insights quickly, I want those insights to pop up to me rather than me going and digging into it and finding out if there is any insight that is worthy of my attention. So that's where custom formatting comes into picture. Click on these three dots on the overflow menu and you will see conditional formatting. It is conditional formatting, not custom formatting. I apologize. So you click on conditional formatting. And when you do that, you have the option of what conditional formatting means, basically means is format the appearance based on a certain condition. So if a condition is satisfied, then format it differently. So it kind of stands out. So right now you have the option of formatting every single column, or you can format the entire row. We'll walk through an example of both of them. So first we will do the entire row formatting. So I'll do entire row. When I select entire row, I have two options right here, add background color or add text color. I'm going to choose add background color. And I'm going to say if the profit is less than zero, then format it differently. Because if it is formatted differently from the rest of the rows, it will stand out to me and I can take action on that. So if the profit is less than zero, which means it is negative, it is not profitable, less than zero, then what do you want to do? You want to highlight that entire row of unprofitable row with a color, which in my case, I'm going to choose brown. Apply. Stay away from using red and green because there are more people than we think who are colorblind. And so for them, by visualization standards, by the visualization gurus, the recommendation is not to use red and green. Instead, go with orange and blue and things like that. So right now I've used brown to highlight the particular row which has a negative profit. Now let's apply and then close. Now I want to add another conditional formatting, which I want to say if the discount is greater than a particular value, then again flag that it is probably not right to give so much of discount, and just to keep a tab on the discount that has been given. So you select the discount column. Now when you select a column, you will see three options. When you selected a row, you only saw add background color or text color, but with a column selection, you will have add icon as well. So I'm going to choose add icon, and I'm going to say if the discount sum, when I say custom conditions, it lets me add what conditions you want So when I say when the discount is greater than or equal to 20, say, apply. So it's automatically, what it has done is it has honored my request that if it is greater than 20, then give me a plus icon, a green color. But I didn't tell it to do anything else with the other, but it still went ahead and automatically did for less than, it is giving a negative sign of red color. So I don't want too many symbols. It takes away from the quick insight, because then there are a lot of symbols that I have to process. Instead, I just wanted a very clean and crisp looking visual. So I'm going to remove the negative signs. I'm just say delete and apply. So it's giving a plus sign, but this doesn't mean anything. I want to indeed say that it is not good to give so much of discount. So that probably should change into an orange. And instead of plus, I want a cross, red, and delete, apply. Right? So the only condition that I want is that if it is greater than, if the discount is greater than 20, then I change this icon set for a check mark or a X, and then I did the color red, or you can make it a little orange, and then apply. So now these are the only rows that I need to be cognizant of, or take some actions, or have a knowledge about. So this is the power of conditional formatting. Next, so now you've done a lot of visuals, a lot of diving deep into your data and understanding what is causing. You've gotten certain insights. So you could do either, you could do all these visuals, or you can just click insights. With just one click here, you've seen that you have tons of insights generated right here. You can go through each of these insights and see if they add value, or if you want to project these insights to your leadership or to your end users, then you can just add it by clicking on the plus button here. And you saw that the lowest month is June 2017, which we kind of discovered here by looking at this trend. And we also did contribution analysis in the beginning, right? So it's automatically projecting that out as well for you. It is telling that your highest month has been January 2015, which you can kind of see that it is January 2015 is the highest month. It started with this big value right here. And then the growth rate, it says what are the top three hospitals, bottom three hospitals. Total cost of 2018 increased by, see, this is exactly what we wanted to see, what happened between 2018 and 2017. So it's giving you right over here that the year over year change has increased from here. So it's a very good insight, which I finally figured by finding out my revenue and profit was showing me that something is wrong, something is going on with the cost. So I can just add that visual right here. So when you add it directly here, it gets it to the top. I'm going to make it small and then move it about. But before I move it, I want to make it a little more smaller than this. And this is just too many numbers for me. Again, going back to making very crisp and precise dashboards, not a lot of information, just the right amount of information to kind of make the end user curious and dig in more with all those principles in mind. I will remove out all these numbers. The way I do that, I can customize this. It's very good that QuickSight is giving me all these insights, but it also is giving me the power to customize these insights to suit my liking. And my liking is not to have so many numbers. So I'm going to click on these three dots here and say customize narrative. And I see that I don't want these numbers, which is starting with from this to this. So it just locate where this particular from is on your top and select all of that and click delete, hit delete. on your keyboard. So now you see the preview is getting updated automatically, and it's saying the total cost for 2018 increased by 12.14%. That's enough for me. I really don't want this big number, so I'm going to be deleting that number as well. Again, this is preview is updating. And I say save. So good. Now I'm going to bring it down here. Okay, this is too big to fit into that space. So all right, I have it right here. I think I missed a bracket right here. Okay, so now I'm going to again make it like a grid structure. Further, right now what we did in terms of customization is just removed a certain thing, but now say you want to change about top three categories, so I'm again going to add that as well, and again the same process of making it really tiny and then moving it down right here. Okay, and then it says the top, I don't want to see the title for this one because the top three category, it kind of says what it is. So the title is redundant. Again, going back to just giving enough information, removing all the redundant information, click on this gear and say show title. It takes it away right here. And then now you see the top three categories are the same. Instead of three, you wanted five categories and not three categories. So what I'll do is, again, I'll go customize insight, click on the three dots here and say customize narrative. And here, right here on the right side, you see computations, click on that. And there is a pencil icon which allows you to customize it. Instead of three results, say you want five results and save. So you see you have now the five categories for total profit. Save. Okay. A lot of customers ask if there is a way to add a text box, because if you see right here on the visual type, you don't see any text box here. But the way we add text box in QuickSight is by using this insights visual type. So add a visual, it automatically adds to the bottom. And we'll make it really small so it fits into that space again. Bring it in right here. Okay. And I'm going to customize this narrative. Okay. It says choose one or more fields. For autograph mode, you need, wait, I want this to be an insight. Okay. Now I made this as a custom insight and say customize insight. Here you will, this is your text box. Here you can type whatever you like, powered by QuickSight, and then you can type it and you'll see the preview. So you'll just see powered by QuickSight. Now I also want to add an image to it. So this is the way you add image, by clicking on this and then you enter the image link. If you have your company's image logo and things like that, you can add it. I'm going to be adding QuickSight logo. So it brings up the QuickSight logo. I know that my visual is very small and I want it a little smaller than this. So I'm going to just squeeze it in. See. So it's brought in powered by QuickSight. I have to squeeze it in a bit more. I'm going to make this a little small and make it center aligned. Make this center aligned as well. Okay. So, well, we don't have so much of space, so I'm just not going to add this instead. Let's get back to our hospital insights. The autosave is always on, so you rest assured your data is all, your visual progress is all saved. I'm going to customize this narrative and stream this. Again, add it. Let's try it again. Okay, so now I have this logo right here. Very good. So I'm liking now the I think I'm complete with all the visual that I wanted to show you, but this is now a very static dashboard. There is really no interactivity. So now I'm going to be proceeding to the next section, which is adding interactivity to your dashboards. So we have action filters. You can add interactivity by using actions or by using filters and by using parameters. So first let's do some actions. You click on this particular visual and say, by just clicking on Downtown Hospital, you want all this data to be updated only for Downtown Hospital. So to do that, I will click on actions right here. After selecting this visual here on which this action should take place, the source of the action is this particular visual, and I click action. And I say filter same sheet visuals, which means every single visual in this sheet will get filtered based on what I select here. So just with one click now, it has created an action. Now you will see here, if I select Downtown Hospital, every single visual is getting updated. And it's just now showing the Downtown Hospital revenue. Everything else is getting updated for the Downtown Hospital. But I don't want this revenue to update for the Downtown Hospital. Just for the context, I just want this particular visual to not get updated. So I'm going to remove that visual from this action. To do that, I click on edit on that action. And I say the target visual, select visuals, don't do for all the visuals. For example, don't do for sum of revenue by admit date, which is this visual. I uncheck this and I click save. Now you'll see that except for this visual, everything else will get updated. Everything is getting updated for whatever I select here. So this is your action filter. Again, if you want to get outside of that action filter, you can just click back and it'll select everything now. Now there is something called URL actions. So for example, I want to, if you say, for example, you're managing the help desk and you have your tickets logged into ServiceNow, or you're a part of a marketing team and you're getting the tweets. So you want to go back to the Twitter ID directly from this visual based on a particular tweet. If you want to see who has posted it and things like that, then you can go back to that same Twitter. On Twitter, you can see that tweet live just by clicking on it. Say, for example, you are a salesperson and you see a sales manager and you see certain sales, certain opportunity IDs which need attention. Then you can click that opportunity ID right here and it will take you to your Salesforce application. So any business application or out on Google or anything on the internet, you can do it via the URL action. For the purposes of this exercise, I will show you how you can get to Google. So the need for me right now is that the moment I click on any category right here, it should take me to Google and explain to me what this category is. So I'll create a action again, action, and I will say define a custom action. And I'll say that on selection, use URL action. And I'll give that URL link. So the generally the Google URL, the way it is constructed is https://google.com/search. And then the query string is category. So this is the column which stores what I'm going to be looking for. In your, say, for example, if you're using Salesforce, then you would put your Salesforce URL, and then you would put the final Salesforce ID or opportunity ID right here. If it is coming from your database, then you would put the column name which is holding that opportunity ID. And when you click on it, it will take you to your Salesforce application. Now I've added this Google and I say save. Now when I click on critical care, it will open up critical care on Google for me. So that's another way of adding interactivity to your dashboard. So we covered both the action filters that we have. Let's now add a parameter. So the say, for example, I want the top five categories to show you. I don't want all of these categories to show you. So we'll add a filter. We'll add a parameter. I want top five, but the end users might want to see top three. Another end user might want to see top nine. So to be able to make it dynamic and cater to all audiences, I'm going to be giving the control to the audience, to the end users, to select how many they want to see. So I'm going to create a parameter for that purpose. Click on parameters and say create one. And type the name of the parameter as, say, top n. It's very important to note that for a top parameter, it definitely needs to be an integer type. If you select number, it won't allow you to do that. It won't allow you, this option will, it will not show you this option for selection when you actually want to use that. So use integer for top n, and it's going to be a single value, not multiple value. Like, I'm not going to have the end user select either top 5 or top 10. At one time, they are able to see either top 5 or top 10. So I'm just saying single value, and the default I'm going to be giving is 5. It's important to give the default value for certain kind of parameters. Like, for example, if you're using the using a parameter in a calculated field, then you need to give a default value. Otherwise, it won't let you use that in a calculated field. So there are certain restrictions in terms of the data type and whether you want to use a static default value or not. So I'm going to be doing that and click create. Now, once I've created the parameter, the second step for creating a parameter is to add that as a control or define where you want to use that parameter. Right now, I'm creating, the purpose of creating this parameter is to give the control back to the user to select. So unless I make it as a control, the user will not be able to interact with this parameter. So I have to give it as a control. When I do that, it is now asking me that how do you want me to show this control? I want to show this control by the name of, like, I want to do a call to action. So I do a verb. I'll say select top, right? And then this style, I want it to be a text box, because in this text box, the user will enter whether they want to see 5, 10, 6. So I'm doing text box and I say add. Now you see it's added that control right here, select top. And by default, I had given it 5. So it is taking that default. Now say I want to change it to 8. Nothing happens. You change it to 3. Nothing happens. The reason is that creating a parameter is a multi-step process. The first two steps were to create the parameter. Second is to use that parameter as a control. Now the third step is to actually link this parameter to your filter, so the actual filtering can happen. All right. So now it is getting the input, but for the output of it, you have to pass it back to a filter. So I'm going to create a filter. And the filter I'm going to create is on the category field because it's going to select the top categories. So category field, and there is a option on the filter list, top and bottom filter. Select that. Now you want to select top three. Either you can give a static value here, 5, 6, again, but going back to the idea of letting the end users choose how much they want to see. So you're going to use a parameter and say yes. And which parameter that you want to select. If you have multiple parameters which are of integer type, all of them will be listed here. I want to use the top end parameter which I just created. Okay, you now QuickSight understands that you want to see top categories, top three categories based on your selection right now. But who is to decide what are those top three categories? So the field that will decide what the top three categories are is the cost field right now here. So I'm going to say cost and say apply. Now you see that it has updated the top three fields right now here. You see, it's not only done top three here, it's also applied it everywhere else, right? The reason being, this filter says apply to all visuals, but we are only after this particular visual. So I will say select only this visual. So now all these numbers revert back to their original numbers. You see what I was doing all this while, I had created this filter by selecting this particular thing. That filter has gotten created here, but I wanted that to be created here. So no fretting, we don't have to create all over again. Instead, we can just say apply this to some visuals and say sum of cost, category and admit date and apply to this, apply. So now it's applied here and here. So if you want, you can go back and change this to apply to only this, but I'm okay with both of this getting updated. So now you have added more interactivity to this dashboard. So now you have the top three selected. Now, this looks good to me. A little bit of adding a little bit more glitter to it before finally publishing this dashboard is you can add glyphs to your dashboard. Because it is talking about revenue, I'm going to be putting, or talking about profit right here, I'm going to put a money bag right here. So if you want to add some glyphs, you can say, I want to put hospital glyph right here. So you just say, go to Google and look for Unicode of hospital. So basically what I'm trying to say is that we do support, QuickSight does support Unicode characters. Go to Emojipedia is a good site. So you can click on that and you can copy that Unicode. It says copied. And come back to your dashboard and place the cursor and say Control B. So now you have that added here. Now almost ready, but still before going in, I want to give a few more final touches in terms of themes. As you can see right now, there is this gutter in between all of these visuals, which I don't like as much. So I'm going to do themes right here. And this is the classic theme which comes with your dashboard. And I'm going to click Save As. When I do Save As, it will give me the option of modifying this theme and making my own theme. So I'm going to say Workshop Theme. Just give it a name. And the primary, I like the white color, so I'm not going to change that. But I think this black is just too much of a black. I would rather have a little bit of gray than black. So I'm going to change that to gray. So if you know the hex codes or RGB values, then you can click on custom color and put that particular value. Okay, I wanted to change this one. Custom color, primary foreground, reapply. Okay, something is wrong. Let me type it now. Instead of copying that value, let me type it. 696363. Now you see it's giving gray color. So now you see from black, it has changed to gray. Not a lot of difference, but I'm a little picky with my dashboard appearance. So I like it this color. Also, I can choose one of these fonts. I'm going to be choosing Comic New. And so now my dashboard has updated to this new format. And now you see these are listed in blue color. It's a little too bright for me. So I'm going to change this. See, you see the accent foreground has changed to white. Okay, which was actually okay, fine, that's fine. Scratch that. Now I'm going to show you how you can go back to your data right here. As you can see that you have these colors right here. This is the order in which those colors are getting selected when you want to add them to your dashboard. And you can choose, you can change those colors as well. So you can add more colors if you know the RGB values or the hex values for your company. If you want to, if you have those branding colors for your company, then you can use those colors and create a theme. And the good thing about themes is you can share this theme across the people on your account. So anybody on your account creating dashboards can use that same theme, and all the dashboards coming out of your theme will have the same look and feel and look very uniform and very nice. So I'm going to add more colors. The way you add colors is click on again, add your custom color and give that the value. And it's a different shade of blue, and I apply. I'm going to add one more color. Control V, click apply. Now, although I've added that, they've got added at the bottom, and but these are the colors which are being used. So I'm going to drag it here so it gets the preference. So you see the dashboard got updated. And I'm going to be giving this color preference. So now it's getting updated with these colors. All right, so you can change the layout, whether you want the margin. What this margin does is put the margin around the dashboard. And if you want to remove the gutters, then you can remove the gutters. And now you still have the border, but say you want to create an infographic or something like that, you can create the, you can remove the border. So it's all kind of in one big canvas. You have all of the different visuals, but I like the borders. I'm just going to keep that, and I'm going to say save. So that's how I saved the theme. But the theme has been saved as a workshop. It has not yet been applied on this. So I will apply this. And now my dashboard will actually get updated with the new theme. And also, I can share this theme to other people on the account by looking them up. If you have people on your account, that you can start looking them up and then say share. When they log in, they will be able to see that theme for you. So this is how you would change the theme on your dashboard. So now I think it's all set. Just one more thing before I will start publishing this out is to add a title. Now I'll add a title to this. Add title. This is the sheet title I can add here. So I'm going to say Hospital Insight. You can make it dynamic as well, which means you can add this top three. Right now the control is So I'm going to say showing top. This is, I can't make it static because it needs to change with whatever they are selecting. So there is the plus icon right here. Click on that and select the parameter top in. So showing top, whatever number is here, it will show that number categories. All right, so now you see you have hospital insights showing top three categories. So this is the title of the dashboard. All right, looks good, ready to be published. So I'm going to now publish this dashboard. The way you share or publish this, and right now what is happening is you've created an insight, but you want to now start sharing this out to other people. For sharing, you can't share an analysis with your end users. Analysis can be shared only with other authors in your account. But if you have readers on your account and they need to see this, then you have to first publish it as a dashboard and then share that dashboard out to other to the readers of your account. So you do share and say publish dashboard. And I'm going to give this name as Hospital Insight Dashboard. Now, I want to draw your attention to these advanced publish options that we have here. For showing you the impact of all these options, I'm going to be publishing this dashboard twice. Once with everything selected on the advanced publish options. So I'm going to call this Hospital Insights Everything Selected and say publish dashboard. Once you publish the dashboard, it automatically gives you the option to share this dashboard with other users on your account. When you say share with all users on your account, it will get shared with everybody on your account and it'll list who it has been shared with. Right now, I don't have other users on this account. So it's just showing myself right here. So now you can close this out and this is your dashboard now. You see that everything was selected in the published dashboard. So as a result of which you're able to see this filter. When you click on this filter, you can select any one visual and say create one filter and it will let you interact. So your end users are able to interact with this dashboard without you as an author kind of having to think what is it that the end user would want to filter it by or interact more with. So this gives the power to the end users to start bringing in filters, slicing and dicing the data as they like. So it's a very important feature geared towards self-serve analytics and such. So you're able to see the filter. Also, what you're able to see is click on it and say analyze contributions to revenue. You can drill up, drill down to a quarter level, right? And also when you hover over something, then you're able to see the tool tips. So you're able to see all of these things, but now I'll show you what happens when you're also able to see this menu right here, which lets you export to CSV. And if you select a table, then you're able to export to Excel also. So you have this, and then you also have the capability of maximizing this. So now if you just want your attention only on one thing and you want to see it big enough, then you can expand it out. So you have all these capabilities as a reader. This is, I'm showing you as a reader. Now going back to that option of, say you don't want to give so much of control to your end users, then you would go to the Hospital Insights analysis, which I created, and I'm going to this time publish it. With none selected. So expand on sheet controls by default, enable ad hoc filtering. So you will not see that left filter right there. You will not see the tool tips. You will not see that how I was able to expand one visual to see it in detail. And then you will not be able to on sheet controls by default. Yeah, so that is what this one is. You see that you have this control. Sometimes this control is hidden and the end users are not able to see it exactly. So to draw attention, you want to publish the dashboard with it expanded. So that this is for that particular purpose. And enable visual menu. Visual menu is that overflow menu, this menu. So that will not be seen if you uncheck that. And if that menu is not shown automatically, your CSV downloads, which were accessible from here, that also won't be shown. And then data point option is when I clicked on it and I told analyze contribution to contribution analysis and things like that, right? So you won't be able to see all those options. And I say public, okay. And I'm going to say hospital insights. It's being a little intelligent and it's telling you whether you want to replace it because you are using that same analysis to publish it out. But right now, because I'm going to be publishing it with different options, I'm saying none selected and publish this dashboard. So you will see the difference of how locked down this dashboard has become now. You see this control top five, it's not expanded. You see that I'm not able to get to analyze contribution to revenue. I'm not able to see that menu to export to CSV or maximize it. I'm not able to drill down, drill up. So everything is locked now. This is just like a more like a static dashboard, if you will. So now the dashboards will be stored on dashboards right here. Everything selected. And you see this control is expanded right here. So the users are able to see that there is something here to interact with. So now we have been able to create a good looking dashboard with machine learning insights here, and then natural language narratives with parameters and reference lines and conditional formatting and things like that. So now I'm going to be showing you more features, especially for parameter. I wanted to show you one more use case of parameters. So let's go back to the analysis. And on another sheet, we'll do a parameter. Say, for example, you have a table and you have category, function, hospital. You want to see the profit. Now, I don't want to see I want to be able to choose whether I want to see the profit of category. Like just choose any of these dimensions or any of these values on demand, right? The user must be able to select them on demand. So I'm going to create a parameter and say if the user, and then the user will select whether they want to see only category, the profit of by category, or they want to see the profit by function, or they want to see the profit by hospital. So I'll create a calculated field and a parameter and show you how these columns can be switched out by the end users. So we'll create first a parameter, add a parameter and name it select metric. Field selector. It's going to be a string, and by default, I'm going to be selecting category, function, and hospital is what I had. Okay, create. Now again, I want to give the control to the end users. So I'm going to say select the field that you want to see, and I'm going to now not give them text box because it will be hard for them to remember the exact names of the fields. So I'm going to give them a single select drop down. When I give a single select drop down, immediately it asks what are the fields that you want in the drop down. Would you be giving me specific values, or should I get that from a data set in the field? Because ours is a different column name, I'm going to be specifying those values right here. So I'm going to be telling them whether you want to see category or you want to see function or you want to see hospital. And at one time, I want to give them to select only one. So I'm going to say hide all option from the value. So it will allow you to select only one and not all of them. And I'll say add. So you see now It's telling you what you want to select, category, function, or hospital. So again, going back that it is a multi-step process. Right now, whatever I do, it will not change anything. I'm going to duplicate this visual to this sheet right here. Okay, now I now want to create a calculated field which will take this input. There should be a way to capture this input from the user. So I'm going to create a calculated field, add a calculated field, and I'll call it field name. And now what I will do is I'll use an if else statement. So this is our very first calculated field which we are creating using a function. So I'm going to say if else that parameter value, which is the field selector, double click on it, it will bring it in your wherever the cursor is placed on the left, it will bring it in. I'll say if field selector is equal to category, then after the comma, you have to put what should it do. If the field selector is category, what should it do? It should give the field category. So see the difference between these two categories. Whenever it is enclosed in curly braces and in brown color, it refers to a field from the data source, data set, or a parameter. But if it is green like this, it means it's a constant or a user given value. So it's comparing to that value category. That string comparison happens here. And then accordingly, if this condition is satisfied, what should happen? Category should come. But if the field selector is hospital, it should show the hospital field. Once I start typing, it automatically pops it here for you. So you select hospital here. So we know that we have given the option of category, hospital, and function. So the else if this, then this. Else if, and the final will be just else, which is they have no other option but to select function because that's what the parameter provides. So we know by default it's going to be function if it is not category or hospital. So we don't need to do another comparison of this nature and just say function. This is your else statement, else portion. So this is where we have captured. Let me copy this and paste it on the chat if you'd like to you create this calculated field. And I say save. All right. So now that calculated field is created, but unless I use that calculated field on the visual, it will not do anything. So I think this color might be a little bit light for you to see. So I'm going to go back and change the theme to the starter themes classic. Okay. So sorry, adjusting this a bit. All right. So now I have this hospital selected here. Now I will be using that newly created calculated field, which is now with an equal sign right here, which is this denotes it's a calculated field. So I'm saying add this field to the visual. Okay. Now you can see, and I'm going to remove the rest because I have the capability to switch between what fields I want to see. So now I have the field name right here. So Downtown Hospital, North Hospital, and South Hospital. If I select category, it will show that category. If I select function, then it will show by function the profit. So this is a way you could use parameter by showing that. Now, next, what I wanted to show was, so either you can choose it this way or you can also add drill downs one feature which I did not show was a drill down feature. So I'm going to be showing that now. I'm going to delete this one because this is what the parameter shows. Now I'm going to add duplicate visual to this sheet. And I'm going to change this to a bar chart and show how drill downs work. Going to category, bring category here. Also bring subcategory. Now, the way you do drill down is a little tricky. Hover over it and say until add drill down. If you do something else, it'll kind of replace it. But if you until you get the add drill down, click here, and now it's added to drill down. And say you want to drill down further from subcategory to say function. So again, you bring it here. So you can add multiple levels of drill down here. Right now, you will see just the category, but the way you know there is a drill down is by this particular arrow here, because this field well is showing you there is a drill down, but to the readers, this field well is not visible. So it's not visible, right? So you would drill down like this and further like this. So this is how you would drill down. Now you want to quickly come back to category from function without going through subcategory, then there is this move immediately to the top level and you are able to drill down. So that's how you do drill down with QuickSight. And let's do another calculated field called length of stay. So we duplicate visual to this sheet, and here we are going to remove. I want to see what is the length of stay for every patient. So I add the patient ID here. I'm going to just make it a table. Okay. And I want to see how long the patients have stayed in the hospital. So I'm going to add a calculated field and subtract. So I have admit date in my data set and I have discharge date in my data set. So I want to find out length of stay. And I'm going to say, you cannot directly subtract two date fields. That'll not work for multiple reasons. So we have a function called date diff, which helps you to subtract to date. The formula or the syntax for that is start typing date diff and it will pop that for you. And here on the right side, you look for the function date diff and click on it. It will give you the syntax of what it is expecting here. So it's expecting your date one and date two and the period. Let's see what it means. Date one basically means the start date and this means the end date. So my start date is the admit date at the hospital. And my end date is the discharge date. So you have the discharge date. Now, you want the difference between the two, but obviously date has a lot of parts to it. Whether you want the difference in the number of days, you want the difference in the number of months, or you want the difference in the number of quarters or years and so on. So I want the difference in date, and that is what is giving is the period that you have to provide here. So you say the difference in days. And you would put a DD. DD denotes day. I'm posting this after checking whether it is correct. So my length of stay is correct. So this is the formula for length of stay. Now I'm going to bring the length of stay to my table right here. And I'm going to sort it by this particular field. So sort descending. By clicking on it, I was able to see that Patient 353 had the longest length of stay, which is 91 days. And then there are so many patients, so you can, but you don't want to see for every single patient. You don't want a scroll bar. You're only interested in the patients which have stayed between, say, 91 to 20 days. So we can add a filter now. This is a very new feature right now when we have on-sheet filter controls. So directly from the length of stay, you can add a filter. So you click on filter and you create a filter on the length of stay. Now, so you want that to be no aggregation. You want that greater than 20. You're interested in everything which is greater than 20 days. So I'm going to say greater than 20 and apply. So this is the filter which is applied here. But if you want to add this to the visual itself, so the end users can select it, then you would say add to sheet, and it will give you option of configuring it. So I'm going to say select range, and minimum value I want to give is say 0, and maximum I want to give 100. And if you move the slider, how many points it should move? So I'm going to say it should move like 5 points, and say add. Now it adds it right here, but you don't want it here. You want to pin it to the top right here. You can either drag and drop it and place it like any other visual. You can drag and drop it on the visual. You can move it around. But for me, I liked it on pinned to the top along with the controls. So now it gets added right there. And I'm going to bring it a little bit up right here. So now I can select as an end user. I can select what range I want. So now it gives all the way right here. This basically means everything above 45. This is highlighted in blue, which means now it's giving you everything above 45. Or now it's giving you everything above 25. It's giving you above 5. So that's how I wanted to show how a measure, bringing a measure to a filter shelf will behave. You will have to create a slider for it, slider control for it. So with that, I think we've come to the time for a quick break. Jill?
Yes, I think we're on perfect timing. It's now 9:47 a.m. Why don't we take a break? I'll give you a full 15 minutes. We'll start at 10:02 a.m. and we'll just be on pause basically for the next 15 minutes. Thanks, Thank everyone. You. I'm going to keep the recording going. A number of you have asked in the chat whether we are recording this, and the answer is yes. The recording will be sent to all attendees and will be available via our Amazon QuickSight YouTube channel within just a day or two. So look for that coming soon. This is your 2-minute warning. We'll be getting started again shortly. Just a shameless plug, we are doing these in-depth immersive workshops, hands-on workshops for the next several weeks. And so I did put a link in the chat window to our upcoming schedule. There's basically 4 core topics, including today's virtual author workshop, which we'll repeat again in November. We also are doing an in-depth workshop next week on embedding and building a reusable embedded framework to build QuickSight directly into your application. Also, topics being covered is the administrative experience with a workshop on November 11th, and kind of an interesting topic on November 4th, we're looking at how you can use QuickSight to visualize your AWS cost and usage report. And so our optics team comes through and goes through a very hands-on workshop on how you can do that. It's fairly self-paced, but the team is available to answer questions through that session. So yeah, that's a little bit of what's coming up. I know that we're all looking forward to the second part of today's session, and we'll be getting started in just about 1 minute.
Welcome back, everyone. I'm going to start sharing. Are you able to see my screen?
Yep, looks great.
Awesome. Thank you. So, welcome back. I know we were supposed to start calculated fields and table calculations and level aware, but I just have two more points to cover before we get there. One is a very important anomaly detection, and the other is showing you how email reports can be scheduled. So we'll finish that very quickly before we jump on to the next set of topics. So with anomaly detection, the way you would do that is, say for example, I created a different sheet right here, and you click on this add and say add insight, and you choose anomaly detection right here from your insight and select. Once you do that, it'll ask you for one dimension and time, one measure value, and at least one dimension and category. So you definitely need to provide this. So for satisfying this condition, I'm going to give the admit date, and I want to see if there's any anomaly in revenue across these years. And I'm going to see the dimension I'm after is the categories. Okay, so I have these three. So the moment that condition satisfies, that pop-up goes away, that message goes away, and it's telling you that you're ready to get started. I can add more to my categories. I can also add hospital right here, right? And then I say get started. Now, it says that there is a cost, additional cost for anomaly detection, which it is, but it's like 50 cents for every 1,000 or 10,000, I'm not sure on that number, but it's on based on thousands of metrics that it is 50 cents. So to determine how many metrics are being processed as part of your anomaly detection, there is a formula to it. For example, I have category and hospital right here. So the category, the cardinality of category, which means I have 9 distinct values in category, which was BMT and NICU and things like that, right? So there are 9 different distinct values of categories, and I have 3 distinct three distinct values in hospital, which is the South Hospital, North Hospital, and Downtown Hospital. So if you select and analyze all combinations of these category, that means that every single category will be analyzed with every single hospital. So all permutation and combinations will happen, and that will decide the number of metrics that you are going to be charged for. So in this case, I have 9 categories. So first it will do each categories and anomaly detection. So you will have 9 plus 3 hospitals. So 9 plus 3 is 12. Plus, it will do 9 into 3, because every category is is getting analyzed with every hospital. So 9 threes are 27. So in all, it will be 12 plus 27, which is 39. So right now, for this particular use case, you will be charged for 39 metrics. You haven't reached that 1,000 or 10,000. I'm sorry, I'm that 10. I'm not sure about, but we can confirm that. But 50 cents will be charged for so many metrics. Right now for this, it is 39 metrics. And I'm going to say computation name. Now, regardless of the number of rows, right, you might have thousands, 10,000, 100,000 rows in your data set, but you will be charged only for the number of metrics that are being processed. We don't charge on the number of rows that it is analyzing. Now you can give a name, because right now what you're doing is you're configuring a schedule for this anomaly detection to run as and when new data keeps coming in to your data set every day or every month. You can schedule this to run on a particular cadence. You can give it a name. I'm going to just leave it at anomaly detection. And I want, my data is coming in every day, so I just keep it at every day. And I say start the schedule on what day. And it also lets you select what time you want it to come. So you can kind of coordinate it with the time that your data is getting refreshed. And then you can choose if it is 10 o'clock, then is it Phoenix time? It's automatically detected and it's given that. Now, next, you can also do contribution analysis. This is optional. This is the same analysis which we saw in the beginning, but we were able to get to that menu from a different visual. But that's also an added feature right here within anomaly detection. If in case it detects an anomaly, then do you want to find out what is it? What are the drivers of that anomaly? So you can select that. I'm not going to be selecting anything for now. And then you have advanced options right here. Now, number of anomalies to display. By default, it is 3. Say, now this is very useful when your widget sizes are fixed. For example, I'm setting up a very large widget right here for anomaly detection. So I can even put 10 or 12 or 15. But say I had a small widget, then I would just say 3. What this means is that although it will display only 3, but you will have the option of exploring the rest of them as well. Just that your visual doesn't get messed up. So this option is provided to you to show only 3, but then you'll have the ability to click on a link and go to see the rest of the anomalies as well. Next, it asks you what severity do you want to display, right? Do you want only anomalies which are very high or high and above, median above, low and above? I will select low and above, which means I don't want it to exclude any anomalies. If it is even seeing the lowest of the anomaly, please show that to me. I want to see that. So that's the severity I have selected. Next is direction. What this means is for metrics like revenue and profit, you want to see lower than expected, right? Because you don't want your revenue to go down or your profit to go down. So I would be seeing lower than expected. But for metrics like cost, if it was higher than expected, then you want to call that as an anomaly. So you can select one or the other based on your use case. Right now, I will select all. So I want to see everything higher or lower for all these metrics that are being processed. And then if you have seasonality in your data, for example, this is a particular Thanksgiving season or something like that, right? If you're a retail shop, and you know that there will be certain spike in your sales and your revenue, probably cost as well. So you can just say that you want to ignore, right? Show anomalies when the difference is greater than X from the expected value. So if you know if it is only more than like 15%, only then show. So if you're expecting some delta for a particular month or a given time frame, and you don't want that to be flagged as an anomaly, then you can provide it here so that notification wouldn't come up. Next is sort by. So the anomaly detection algorithm, which is a random cut forest algorithm, will give you a score for that anomaly. So do you want to honor that and want to see the anomaly with the highest score? Or do you rather just want the difference from the expected value? Say, for example, it was 20,000 all this year, suddenly it spiked up to 100,000. So do you want to, regardless of the anomaly score, you just want to see what is the difference from the expected value, sorted that way. So these are some of the options you can sort your anomalies by. I click save. And now the insight is configured. On that schedule, it will run for you automatically. But right now, for the purposes of this demo, I want to run it right now. So I'm saying run now. And it will take a couple minutes for this to run. In the meantime, I'd like to show you the email option, right? So once your dashboard is created, you can then share it out as an email report. When you click that email report, it will tell you whether you want this to be a one time or you want to have it as a particular cadence. The lowest you can go is once a day and week and month. And when does the first report go out? Again, at what time zone? If you want it to go out immediately after your data is refreshed, so it gives you that latest snapshot in your report, then you want to schedule that time and give the time zone. If you want a subject line on your report, you want the report title, and if you have any other message to send out, then you can have that as well. Do you want to optimize that report? Do you think your users are going to be seeing this email on a mobile device, or you want to see it as a desktop? Then you can optimize that report for that. And then here you will add people who in all this report should go out to. Okay, and then you can, right now I am going to do a send test report. So it will send a report. It's going to be send a, it will send a report to me of this email with a snapshot. When you get that email, you will also have a link to unsubscribe to that email. Now, email is also charged at just like, so basically you will get one reader session along with that email. So what that means is that once an email is sent out, you will be charged 30 cents, which is like a credit for a one forward session, which means you will have a link to that original report in your email. And when you click on that, it will take you to the QuickSight portal where you can actually go to the dashboard and interact with it and other things. Right now, the email sends you the very first, if your dashboard has multiple sheets, it will send you the picture of the first sheet of your dashboard. I'm going to click cancel here. And okay, and that is what it is. So that's how you will schedule email. And let's go to see. Okay, we had, now this has completed running. Your anomaly detection has completed running now. And you see that it detected that medical was 31,000 higher than the expected 1,000 for December 10. I just found one anomaly, although I had configured it to show at least three, it's showing only one because it, that's how much it detected. And if I want to see further into it, then I can click explore anomalies. And like I mentioned, there were going to be 39 metrics that were going to be processed. So you'll be charged for so much, the fractions. And then you can, it'll just show the things what is right here. So not much of information there. Okay, yeah, so it's showing, this is the December 10th anomaly. Okay, so let me go back to a different one for this purpose, explore anomalies. So in this one, I did not select multiple categories and hospital. I just selected category for this one. And so only nine metrics, which were nine different categories I have there. So it did only nine metrics processing. And you can see that it has for December 10th, you can see everything is like very low, but suddenly there is a peak right here on December 10th, and that's what it is flagging as, and everything else is low. So it's flagging that as an anomaly so far. Ideally, this one also should show a particular graph like that, but I am not able to see it right now. So we can check on that later. And so with that, I am done with the first section of visualizations and the formatting and anomaly detection. So now we will move on to the calculated fields and table calculations. So for that one, first I'll create a pivot table. Pivot table is this one, and this is the regular table. When I do pivot table, I'm able to add rows and columns, but when I do a table, then you just have the group by well right here. So I go to the pivot table and I'm going to say admit date and category, and I'm going to see my revenue. All right, so, let me aggregate it at a higher level. Say we want to do it at a yearly level. Okay, so now I can see my revenue here, Now I want to know which particular category is the highest in revenue. So I want to rank it like that. So I'm going to be ranking on the revenue. So I'm adding this revenue again because I want to rank on the revenue. I want to add it again. Normally when I add, I click on it and it gets added. But now what happened was because revenue was already there, it removed it. So to overcome that, I'm going to drag and drop this revenue right here and say add. Now I have two revenues right here. But the point I brought in the second revenue was that I wanted to rank this. So I'm going to change this into a rank function. Click on this and add table calculation and say rank. So it is, you don't have to create any calculated field to come up to that rank. Instead, you can just use the feature which is available directly for a pivot table rank. Now you see that everything is given a rank of one. Doesn't make sense, right? What it is doing is it's doing table across. The direction in which it compares your data to arrive at that particular metric is important. Right now, if you see this revenue sum, calculate as, so you added a table calculation of rank and then you went to your calculate as and you do table across. What it is doing is it is looking for 20 revenue here and revenue across, but there is no revenue across. It's instead it's revenue down. The revenue is listed as column right here. So we have to say to go down the table and not across the table because it needs to compare and rank the revenues which are down the table. So we'll say table down. Perfect. Now it looks so surgical is the number one revenue for 2015. And then you see that across the board, it's been ranking them from the time the data is available, which is 2015, all in one. But I'd rather like to see every single year which category is one and which category is at the bottom, which means what I'm wanting it to do is group by the year. I don't want it to rank continuously across my admit date. So we have another option for that, and that is click on this revenue sum field. Well, we have added the table calculation rank. We have given the order as table down, but we now have to give group down, which means it's going to group each one of these admit dates and change that ranking. So I do group down, and now you see that the ranking is 1 through 9 for 2015, 1 through 9 for 2016, and for all of the years, it is doing the rank for its own set of categories. I can sort this descending or rather ascending. So surgical is the number one revenue for 2015, and so it is for 2016, 2017, clearly a winner across the board, surgical. And looks like NICU is at the bottom for the first 2 years, but it has moved to the eighth spot in 2017 and to seven. So it's improving. NICU has improved since the start. So that's how you would do a ranking. Although the data looks good, but the title doesn't match with the data, right? So we want to change that as well. Click here, and then there is an option for you to hide the title. If you don't want this title to show, then you can just say show title and it will hide there. But if you want to change the name of this particular revenue, which is the second one right here, you can just start typing on top of it and it will now change it to rank. And now these are ranked nicely. So this is how you would use the table calculations in pivot table. Remember, these calculations don't work on any other visual types. Like if you want to do it on a graph, on a bar graph or line graph, you will not be able to do this kind of a calculation. You have to create a calculated field and use a rank function for that. I'll give you one more example of pivot table before we move on to creating level aware aggregations. So we duplicate this visual. Now remember, you can duplicate the visual to this sheet, or you can duplicate, put this visual on another sheet. So very easy to duplicating visuals, and you don't have to recreate them if you, and by accident, if you have created in a different sheet and you rather add it to a different sheet, so it makes more sense and tells the complete picture or talks to a story, then you can move them around very easily. So I'm going to duplicate this visual to this sheet right now, and I'm going to move the category to the columns. So now it looks like a good pivot table right here. Rather, let me move this to the columns and this to the rows. So now I have category on the rows and columns on the year. Now I'll filter. I just want the 2018 and 2017 data for now. So I'm going to add a filter and create one on admit date between 2018, 2017. No, I don't want to use a parameter. And 2018. Instead of doing that, I'm going to say 2019. This is an easier way to get to it. Apply. All right. Now, I'm going to remove. Okay, now, what I want to do is I want to do percentage of total, percentage difference I want to do. So I will change this. Right now it's showing rank, but I want percentage difference. So I'm going to change the table calculation from rank to percentage difference. Okay, now what is it doing? It's now doing down, because that one was configured to go down the table. But what am I after? I'm after finding the difference between 2017 and 2018. But what this is doing is finding the difference between postpartum and BMT revenues. That's not what I want. I want the difference between the two. So, and that too, I want the difference between 2017 and 2018. So I'm going to sort this first, and that's how it will do the difference. Sort by A to Z, which means it will do 2017 first and then 2018. And now I want to change this rank to percentage difference. So I could change the value name as percentage difference. Okay, so now the heading looks good, but the data is still not correct. So we will we will now to click on the value shelf and say calculate as table across. So now it's done the difference between 2017 category between the 2 years. So it's saying that in 2017, this revenue was much higher than this revenue. In fact, it was 25%. It's gone down 25% in 2018. So that's a quick way of doing a table across, table down, and then this is group down as well. Now let's do some. Calculated fields. Create, I'm just going to go to another sheet and I'm going to bring in, I'm going to create a bar chart. And I'm going to add admit date and revenue. And this time I'm going to select the aggregation as month. All right. So now I have the month and revenue. I see all these bars, which is good. Now say I want to do a cumulative since 2015, how much has the revenue, what is the cumulative revenue or running total of revenue starting 2015? So for that, we will use running sum function. Let's create that calculated field. Add calculated field, and we'll call this running totals and the function that we will use for finding the running sum or cumulative sum is called running totals, running sum, RU. So when you start typing, you will see that you have this running sum. This is what we're going to do. Now we have this, it's expecting some parameters. We don't know what it is. So this is where we will go to for help by clicking on running sum. And here it says the syntax needs to be an aggregated measure, the sort attribute, and whether you want it to be ascending or descending. And if you have multiple sort attributes, then feel free to add them as well. And make sure to enclose them within square brackets. And then partition by attribute as well. For this purpose, I'm not going to be showing partition by attribute right now. We will do it after this calculation, but just want to show you the running sum with the first portion of it. The partition by attribute is optional in this case. So let's do aggregated measure. So it's looking for a measure, and what we are after is the revenue. So we're wanting to know the running sum of the revenue. Now remember, if you give just revenue, it's going to give you an error because it clearly states that it wants an aggregated measure. So we have to give an aggregation. It can be sum, average, min, max. But I want to sum up the revenue and of at the level of the visualization, which is the month right now. And then I will have to do a running sum of all the months together. So that's why I'm using a sum inside of this. Okay, so this is the sum of revenue. And then next, if what it asks me is the sort attribute. What is the sort attribute? Basically, I want to sum the admit date. So I'm going to say admit date right here. Because I'm going to be summing across the admit date, but I don't want the 2018 revenue to be added to 2017 revenue and 2016 revenue. That will not make sense because the line will be plotted in the opposite direction. I want it. I want 2015 to be added to 2016, 2016 to 2017, so forth. So the order is ascending and not descending. So that's why I have to give the order as ascending. Now I'm going to close this. There is one thing wrong about this is that it expects this to be in square brackets. So if I say save, it's going to give me an error. So just wanted to call your attention to that, that there are certain syntaxes that you will need to follow. And in this case, it's going to be a square bracket. And save. Okay. So what was that field we created just now is called running totals. Okay, I'm going to change this visual type from a bar chart to a stacked bar combo chart. It's basically a combo chart, which means you can have two measures on it at the same time. So I'm changing this. Once I change that, you see that it added another measures shelf right here. So now while the first chart is showing me the revenue for every single month, the second line, what I want to draw is to show that cumulative numbers, which is running across. So you see your revenue has reached 20 million. So you see that there are two axes drawn now because you have two measures here. One is doing the running totals and the other is doing the revenue for every single month. This is like that. Now, duplicate this visual to this sheet and remember, I wanted to show you how to add the partition also. So the same formula. Let me paste this formula in the chat. Cancel, and I'm going to create another calculated field and I'm going to call that as reset it by every month, right? So reset running total. Lack of a better title. So this formula is correct, but now I need the partition by attribute as well. We'll add the partition by attribute. What that means is, do you want to group by the sum, like reset the counting? So yes, I want all the 2015 months, January, February, March of 2015. Then once the date changes to 2016, then don't include 2015 data in it. Instead, start reset that count. from 2016 January to 2016 December. So that's when you will do the partition by attribute. So the partition by attribute for adding that, it is the admit date again, but at the year level. So you're changing that counting at the year level. So you will have to just get the year portion of your admit date. The way you get extract a year portion or a month or a week or a day is using the trunk date function. So you will start typing the trunk date. And as usual, you go back to here and see what the syntax is. So the trunk date is the period comma date. So right now the period that we are after is the year, because we want to reset the counting for every year. When the year changes, you want to reset the count. And that's the period. As you can see, it has to be YYY. And if you want week, then it is WK. Now date. So you give comma the admit date. Again, remember this needs to be in, if you go to that running sum function again, syntax, this needs to be in a square bracket. So let's put this entire thing in a square bracket. I'm pasting this in the chat. Now let's see how this is different from the running totals. What did we mean that as? Now reset running total. So now you can see how this is resetting for every year. It's again starting to count again from the January to December. It's not a continuous line starting from 2015. So that's how the partition works for running sum. Now, finally, we are at the most interesting topic, which is the level aware aggregations. Now, when I to explain what level aware aggregation means, I will bring in the admit date and I'll bring in category. Rather, let me remove this and let's add cost. And duplicate this to month. And so what it is doing is, it is aggregating at the level of the visualization. What that means is, you are giving this cost, but it's giving you at the month level. When you change that level of aggregation at the visualization level to year, then what it is doing, it is adding all the cost for the year and it is aggregating it. So whatever you define the aggregation level, it will aggregate by that. But level aware aggregates helps you to define the aggregates which is not at the visualization level. Rather, you can control what that aggregation should be by using pre-ag, pre-filter. All right, so let's work with an example of why would you need something like this. Say, for example, you want to divide your customer base as by the revenue. For example, if your revenue is greater than 10,000 for a particular patient ID, then make that patient ID as a high revenue customer. If the revenue is greater than 1,000, then it is a medium. And if it is less than 1,000, then it is a low. So you're basically making your dividing your customers into three different buckets. Now, what happens when I create this calculated field without any level aware aggregation. It's a simple calculated field I will create for that. And I will say patient classification. And I'll say if else the revenue is greater than 10,000, then you call it as a high. If the revenue is greater than 1,000, then you call medium. And if the revenue is greater than, otherwise it's going to be low. That's it. We don't have to do that again. So we call that bucket low. Okay, so this is the ordinary thing that we did. I'm going to paste this in the chat window. So this is a normal calculated field without using any level aware aggregations, and I'm going to say save. And I have, this is not needed. I was just using this for explaining what level of visualization aggregation means. So now to know about level aware aggregations, I'm going to be creating a simple table, and I'm going to say patient classification. So I'm bringing the patient classification, and I'm saying what is the revenue by the patient classification, making it a table. So what I have done is the formula that I pasted on the chat window, that formula is the patient classification. It will give you a, this is, remember, this is a little different. It is giving, the output is here is a dimension and not a measure, because what you're doing is you're creating strings like high, medium, low. So that's a dimension and not a measure. So this is the calculated field which you created, and this is the revenue. Now I will create the similar classification, but using a level aware aggregates. When you use level aware aggregates, you use keywords like pre-ag and pre-filter. So what that does is, it will calculate the revenue at a patient level and not at the patient classification level. I'll show you what I mean when I say that. So let's create a calculated field. And I'm going to use sum over function for using that level aware aggregation. So sum over, look at the syntax. It needs a measure. Now, it does not need an aggregated measure in this case. It needs a measure. So let's just put revenue and not sum of revenue. Revenue. And you want the revenue at one patient level. Now, this patient would have been admitted to the hospital at various times. So there might be multiple records of this patient. But what I want is, if a patient has spent more than 10,000, regardless of the hospital that he was admitted to, regardless of the number of times he was admitted to, I want the revenue of that patient at the patient level and not at the row level. So I will say that calculate the sum over the patient ID, overall revenue for this patient. And the keyword that needs to be used, which tells it is a level aware aggregation. It is pre-aggregate level. Before aggregating it at the visual level, pre-aggregate it here. That's what you're telling it to do. And we are going to call this as revenue per patient, because that's what it is doing. It is getting you the revenue for this patient, regardless of the hospital or the number of times that the person has come to the hospital. So this is your revenue per patient, save. Okay, there is an error here. The reason being, I need to put a square bracket right here. Okay, I'm going to paste this right here. So use that particular formulae in a calculated field and name it as revenue per patient. Now, we created a patient classification based off of just the revenue for every row, but now I'm going to create another patient classification based off of this revenue per patient, not just revenue, but revenue per patient. So let's see how it acts differently when I do that. Another calculated field, call it level aware aggregate patient classification. The same formula that we used last time, except for revenue, you would use revenue per patient, because you are pre-aggregating this revenue instead of at the level of the visualization. So 10,000, revenue per patient greater than 1,000, comma low. So this is the formula I'm pasting on the chat window, which is the patient classification level aware aggregate. So this is giving the regular patient classification. This is giving the level aware aggregate patient classification. Now I'll add a total to this so you can better appreciate. See, the totals are exactly matching whether you're using a regular patient classification or level aware aggregate patient classification, but within these buckets, something is wrong. The numbers don't match. Let's see what happened here. To show what changed, I'm going to be introducing a field, patient ID field. And similarly, I'm going to introduce a patient ID field. Now you'll see, make it a little bigger. I know for a fact that there is a particular patient which will help uncover what is happening. So I know that patient is called patient ID 1-4. So I'm going to filter this on that particular patient. Now, this patient ID has a lot of unique values. So that filter list will be long here, but I know that patient is 1-4 and apply. And let's apply this on all visuals here. Okay, so you see that, okay. It is including, okay, so I just needed to include just 1-4. Okay, now it will only select 1-4. All right, so now you see the difference between this and this. Because this patient was admitted twice, first time this patient had a revenue of 1,000 and the second time the patient had the revenue of 46,000. So when you don't use level aware aggregation, it is just giving it into two, it's giving the same patient ID, but in both the buckets because that condition satisfied. But when we are doing a level aware aggregate, this condition is not satisfied. Basically what it's doing is before bringing it as in high or medium low, it is in advance, it is adding up the revenues of that patient together and then saying the total revenue of this patient is 46 plus 1.5, which is 48. And that's how it's aggregating it correctly in the high bucket. So that is the reason why one of the use cases when level aware aggregates come in handy. We'll do one more example of a pre-filter. This I showed was pre-aggregation. Now I'll show pre-filter. Pre-filters come handy when you want to do percentage of total kind of calculations. So I will add a table visual again, and then I'll add category. And I want to do revenue. And then I want to do percentage of total. Another revenue will bring in. Well, we have this revenue. Okay, now we'll create a calculated field and regular calculated field, creating a percentage of total of this. So I want to know how much percentage did BMT category contribute towards the total revenue is what I am wanting to do. So for that, we have a function called percentage of total. So we'll create a calculated field called percentage of total. And we'll do percent of total, looking for the syntax, it needs an aggregated measure. So I'm going to be giving it sum of revenue. And it tells me to give a partition by attribute within square brackets. This is not optional. You definitely have to provide that. Basically, I want this one across the board. I'm going to just give empty brackets there and save it. Let's see what happened here. I think I have an extra. Okay, this is the sum of revenue I'm looking for. Okay, so go ahead and create the percentage of total, regular percentage of total. And bring it right here so you can place it right by your revenue. Now it's giving in a decimal format. I want to change it as a percentage. I will say show as percentage by clicking on the field well. The same place where we change the formatting, we can also change format we want the number to be displayed. So you can see that BMT is contributed to 3%, critical care is contributing to 14%, and your biggest is surgical, which is 29%, right? Whereas BMT is only 3%. Okay, so now watch what happens when I add a filter. Say for example, I am the manager or for only BMT and critical care. So I don't want to see other data here. I'm just bothered about myself. So I'll say filter on the category. And I'm just wanting to see BMT and NICU, say. BMT and NICU. Remember, BMT is 3%, NICU is 2%. Apply. Watch what happened. It made it 53% and 46%, which is not correct. What it is doing is, because you filtered those records, it's filtering those records from the denominator, which is the total revenue across the board, which is incorrect. It's, even though I'm not interested in other data, does not mean that I'm not wanting to know the percentage of total, the accurate percentage of total for my units that I'm managing. So to honor that denominator, which is the total revenue across the board, regardless of whatever filter we apply in the visualization, we have to create a calculated field called pre-filter. So that pre-filter will honor the whole revenue. It will not, it will be calculated before these filters are applied. So we add a calculated field. And we'll call it fixed total revenue. The total revenue basically across the board, I want the fixed total revenue. I don't want it to change based on the filter because this is the denominator of the percentage to total calculation. So I'm going to say sum over and revenue and across the board. I don't want it to partition by anything. Across the entire table, I want that. And then I'll say pre-filter. So this is my denominator, which will not participate in the filtering condition. I pasted that in the chat window for you. So you have the fixed total revenue, which we will use for the percentage of total calculation. Okay, now I will remove this filter, select all again. And I will add the fixed total revenue, which I just created to it. Now you see, this is the revenue and this is the fixed total revenue. It's the same across the board, which means it is not affected by this category. It's rather just summing up. If I put totals here, this is a total of 18,000. So this is what it is holding. It is holding that total 18,000. Whatever you do to it, you apply any filter, you change the level of visualization, you do totals, it will always hold that value 18,000, the 18 million value, sorry. All right. So which means it's not changing by the level of aggregation of the visual. Let's try if it will hold ground even if I remove the filters. Yes, it did. It did not change. Although these numbers change, this did not change. So now I have a perfect denominator for my percentage of total. So now I will use this one as a denominator, and the numerator will be the revenue of each of these categories. So another calculated field is needed. This is the correct percentage of total which we are going to create. Or we can rather call it pre-filter or level aware aggregate percentage of total, which is sum the revenue at the visualization level, because I'm not specifying any level aware aggregate, and divided by the fixed total revenue which I just created. Now remember, whenever you do numerator by denominator kind of calculations, create calculated fields, you have to wrap your numerator in an aggregate field in a function, and you have to wrap the denominator also in an aggregate function. Only then your answer will be correct. Otherwise, what it does is it will, for every single row of your data, it will divide the numerator and denominator, and finally it will end it. So you should know that sum of revenue by fixed total revenue. These two are totally different answers. You will get totally different answers if you just do the numerator by denominator. You absolutely have to wrap the numerator and the denominator in an aggregate function. Only then it will give you the correct answer. So now you would ask, why am I using minimum and not sum? The reason being, you saw that every single row there had 18 million, regardless of whatever the level of visualization is. So that does not mean I want to sum all of those 18 million. That would be incorrect, because 18 million is just that total value. So if I use min or if I use average max, it will give me the same answer. So I'm just rolling with min for now. So this is your level aware aggregate, pasting it in the window, and say save. All right, so now I'm going to bring in that particular visual which we created, which is the LAA percentage of total. And show this as a format this as a percentage. No, show this as a percentage. Now I'll bring it closer to this one so you can place them by side. And we don't need this one now. So this is the revenue. This is the percentage of total. I'm going to use all the parameters, apply. So when I'm having everything, both these numbers match. But the moment I remove, it's giving me incorrect answers. So this is absolutely not 36%. It's only 29%. So this is your this is the correct way you could find percentage of total. All right. So with that, we come to the end of the workshop today. Over to Jill for some closing comments.
Yes, thank you so much, Sapna, for taking us through so many great examples. I hope that everyone who attended was able to gain a lot of value by going through it in such detail and by doing it themselves. So just wanted to flag, as we mentioned earlier, we will plan to send the recording of today's session to everyone via email within the next day or two. A reminder, we actually posted earlier, and I'll post it one more time here, the QuickSight YouTube channel, which is where we're posting all of the recordings of our fall workshop series. There are a couple of examples already up there with our a previous version of this workshop, our admin workshop, and our cost optimization workshop. Next week's session will be focused on embedding, which will be a really important and exciting way to connect with our solutions architect on how to build an embedded reusable framework. For any additional questions, feel free to reach out to me. My email address is on our confirmation. And again, the upcoming sessions are noted in a link that I'll add again to our chat here. I'd be remiss if I didn't also just make the announcement. If you haven't checked it lately, check the Amazon QuickSight pricing page, because we did just in the last week or two roll out some exciting new capacity pricing that makes it as affordable as ever to use QuickSight for embedded high scale solutions. And so with that, I think we'll close out today. If there are still a couple of lingering questions, we'll do our best to get answers to you. I know that the Answer Hub community is going to be closely monitored for the next couple of days, especially because of the workshop that we've done today. So if you do have a question that comes up after our session today, the very best place to go ahead and post those questions, because of the large number of people who are looking at those, is in our QuickSight Answer Hub. So just look in the chat here for a couple of additional resources. And if you're sharing this with any colleagues, a good thing to pair with the recording is the content that I've just posted. And again, the recording will be sent via YouTube. So thanks everyone for your time today, and we hope you have a great rest of the day.